Hi folks, CodeTutor here, and my name is Anil Deshpande. Let's assume that you have an idea and you want to implement it. You want to basically code it. You don't start your day by saying, let me start by writing a bad code. Nobody wants to write a bad code. Everybody wants to write a good code. But how does a good code look like? I'm pretty sure sometimes you wish I knew how a bad code looks like. Because if you know how a bad code looks like, you can then avoid making those mistakes and write better code. So until and unless you look at some bad code, it is very difficult to make a judgment of how a good code looks like. So time to look at some bad code. Even though the code I am using here is Kotlin, what I am going to discuss here is very much agnostic of programming language per se. You can apply this to Java, Python, anything for that matter. So here is an example code. You have a class called email service and it has a function send mail, takes a message which is of type string parameter. Now you have another class called as notification service and it has a function notify user and it uses email service.send mail from the email service to basically send the message. Looks pretty innocent code here, but when you look at it very closely, you can actually start seeing the problem with this particular code. Let's look at the email service instantiation in the notification service. If we want to switch the email service with something else, say for example, SMS service, we are basically forced to modify the class implementation inside the notification service without having to touch or change in the notification service. I can't implement this particular feature. So in a way, this class hierarchy is implemented. It is very, very inflexible and it is not reusable, because if I want to use a notification service that uses a SMS service rather than a email service, then I can't use the notification service. So the notification service can't be reused if I want to change the service that it uses inside. So in a way, this is not reusable or unreusable. And because of that, over a period of time, this code basically becomes unmaintainable. Not only that, email service is instantiated directly inside it. Because of that, you can't test this in isolation, as we won't be able to pass a mock email service to the notification service. So that basically makes this notification service untestable. You will see this kind of things at lot of places. Let's have a look at another code. There is a class logger and there is a user service. User service uses the logger. And once again, the logger is directly instantiated inside the user service. Well, if you want to switch a logger with something else, you can't do that unless you come and start modifying the user service. So once again, the same problems can crop up here as well. It is unreusable, inflexible, and unmaintainable. And user service can't be tested in isolation because I can't mock the logger if I want to test the user service. So basically, it is untestable. Let's have another look. I have a class called as database service, and then service provider has an instance of database service and it is initialized inside the service provider. Once again, I can't change the service that service provider uses internally until and unless I start changing the implementation of this service provider itself. So once again, it is unreusable, inflexible, and unmaintainable. And because the database service is getting instantiated directly in the service provider, I can't test it in isolation. So it is once again very much untestable. So by now, I think the words untestable, inflexible, unreusable, and unmaintainable should have become familiar with you, and you also understand what they actually mean in terms of the code. So if this is how a bad code looks like, how should a good code be? It should be flexible, it should be testable, it should be reusable, and it should be easily maintainable. So now, since you understand what should be a good code be, I'm pretty sure you are thinking, are there any set of rules and guidelines that I can follow to achieve these four things? That is, a flexible, testable, reusable, and maintainable code. And the answer is yes, and those are solid principles. The main person who can be called as the proponent of solid principles is this guy. His name is Robert C. Martin. If this name doesn't ring you any bell, then probably the name Uncle Bob should give you some idea. This is the man who basically came up with these principles in his seminary book called as Agile Software Development Principles, Patterns and Practices. This was way back in 2002. Well, the solid principles are not just name because they are solid. It is actually a abbreviation. S stands for Single Responsibility Principle, also called as SRP. O stands for Open and Closed Principle, or OCP. L stands for Lescois Substitution Principle, or LSP. I stands for Interface Segregation Principle, or ISP. And last but not the least, D stands for Dependency Inversion Principle, that is DIP. So as a part of this series, we will understand each of these things in a very detailed manner. And we will get started with the very first one, which is Single Responsibility Principle. So what is Single Responsibility Principle? Well, the definition is a class should only have single responsibility. There is another version of this definition, which basically says a class should have only one reason to change. Let's have a look at that faulty code that we were looking at a moment back and try to see that code through the prism of single responsibility principle. What is the responsibility of the email service? Sending a mail. Is it doing anything other than that? Well, no. So we are good here. Now, let's have a look at the notification service. What is notification service supposed to do? Well, based on the way it has been named, basically manage notifications. Notify user function seems to use to indicate that. So we are good there. But why is it instantiating email service? Some might say, well, notification service needs it to send email under notify user function. We don't have problem with that argument. The problem is, why does it need to instantiate email service to be able to notify the user? It's like saying, to be able to send a mail, I should construct the post office. Does it make any sense? No. There is another problem here that we can understand if we spend more time looking at it. If the notification mechanism changes, for example, SMS notification, I will have to start changing the implementation of the notification service. The another aspect is, if implementation of email service changes, let's say you introduce priority mail service, but I can't use it in the notification service without having to come to notification service and change the instantiation logic, because the code is tightly coupled. So all of these indicate that the notification service has more than one reason to change, and that is a problem. And that is the reason why the statement class should have only one single responsibility. There should be only one reason to change a class. Some of you might say, Anil, this is too simple of an example. In reality, I don't think that I face this. Well, let me show you in a real application. This is the application that we have built some time back in the previous video series, which is basically the implementation of country list in the scrollable lazy column backed up with room database. Let's have a look at the view model here. It has all countries. It basically maintains the countries. There is a selected country for deletion, selected country for updation. Then there are functions here, fetch, get all countries, delete, update. So of course there are clearly some business logic here. But other than this business logic and maintaining these all countries, which is actual data model that you might render on the screen, there is something else here. Is loading, show delete alert dialog, show update dialog alert. This is not really a business logic. it is something else. It is basically managing the UI of the application. So this class country view model is basically violating the single responsibility principle. It is mixing two things. One, the business logic, and the other one, which is the UI logic. And this basically violates the single responsibility principle. So I hope now you understand how to identify the single responsibility principle in your code. In the next video, we will continue to go through the code and analyze it through the prisms of various solid principles. So stay tuned for the next video. That brings us to the end of this particular video. Don't forget to like, comment, share the video, and subscribe to the channel. Take care. Bye.